A big reason I started making games is I have so many stories and funniness to share with people. That to me meant giving the players enough crazy and safe choices. That meant narrative branching. That meant choices matter, and for a game to do that, it would need a solid dialogue system. This is also to preserve the sanity of the writer slash game dev. I made a JSON dialog system for Dorian Pink, and you write the story and narrative branching in Excel or Google Sheets. It was my first dialog system, and it was the most difficult thing I've coded at the time. It worked for Dorian Pink, but there are imperfections. A lot of things had to be done manually still. For instance, it was my first game, I didn't know shit about localization, aka translation, introducing the complication. This is the official format for localization in Godot, if you're interested. All your lines of dialogue must be assigned a key. The header row must be named accordingly, starting with keys and the official Godot language codes. So all Japanese translations go here, all Spanish go here, for instance. You can export this then as a CSV file and import it directly into Godot. There are many tutorials on how to import it, so that means for your JSON dialog file, instead of using the actual dialog lines, you have to replace them with the keys. If your CSV file is formatted correctly, Godot will automatically swap out the keys with the dialog in the desired language. The way my old dialog system was set up, I'd either have to replace the dialog text with the dialog keys manually, one by freaking one, or create some sort of parser to extract just the text from the JSON file. The end result was messy because JSON jumbles up the sentence order. It forcefully arranges it by alphabetical order, etc. Just a bunch of headache stuff. There was just a lot of inefficiency that I wasn't experienced enough to account for. So for my next narrative game, I want an upgrade. I would need an upgraded dialogue system, with consideration for localization, global variables, heavy narrative branching, etc. I recommend you to check out the video on my previous dialogue system if you haven't already. It covers the basic things you need to create a dialogue system. It's more of a bird's eye view video, I didn't go into nitty-gritty tutorials there. It will help you understand this sequel video more. Let me bring you through my process and planning for this ultimate dialogue system. First, we need foresight. Let's consider a few potential practical issues with the dialogue system. First, when game devs make systems such as dialogue systems and inventory systems, those systems ideally can be reused in the next game and the next game and the next game with minimal tweaks. Secondly, if in the future you want to bring in other writers or game designers to your project, it would be great to have a dialogue system that's more visually intuitive, that they can easily pick up or debug or edit. So this means we need a visual editor, for this dialogue system anyway. The components of my new dialogue system are story, visual editor, dialogue parser, and then finally the JSON file. First, you need your story. From the story you want to tell and the game mechanics you want to employ, you can decide what features your dialogue system needs. Here are the features of my new dialogue system. Character name. The character name is for assigning the profile pictures to the characters, so it's largely backend. And the display name, sometimes when you don't see which character is on screen yet, so you want to put question marks for the mystery, and having conditionals that you can stack, so a lot of if-else statements. Line assets, for example, voice files attached to the line of the dialogue. In the future, if you have different voice acting for different languages, this would come in handy. And other implied features are using the player input in the dialogue, and having a new dialogue line in every line break. I want something similar to Disco Elysium, where you have a random dice roll and some backend skill checks, and depending on your skill and luck, dialogue options may or may not show. This can all be coded into the dialogue parser. Try to look as far ahead as you can. For example, if you want to make it easy to localize in the future, you could code your system so that it saves all the text into a text file that you can paste into your localization sheet. Next, we have the visual editor. Again, you don't really need this, but since I want to use this dialogue system for future games as well and be able to keep track of all the branching visually, I decided to make my dialogue system a visual editor. I recommend a few GDC branching narrative talks that I've watched before making my dialogue system. Learning from the trial and errors helps you to foresee any potential bugs and organize your system to avoid them. Links below. For example, my new dialogue system is not perfect because the lines get all tangled up often. I'm lazy to improve upon that as of this moment, but it might pose problems in the future. For now, my way of keeping the tangos in check is to create the branching in chapters, so not the whole story all in one file all at once. Let me bring you through the visual editor. So everything starts at this part, which is the file path. If I have an old file that I want to open up, then I can put the name of the file here and it's going to open up in the visual editor like how I saved it. But if we have a new file that we want to make, we can go ahead and name it a new name and it's going to create a new file for us in the directory. Perfect. So there are three types of nodes that we can choose from. The first one is just a normal node. It has the node title. And once you type it in, it's going to change up here as well. And then, of course, the text. The character is going to be Santa. And let's say Santa says, ho, ho, ho. My name is Santa. And there are, of course, the other features that comes with the normal node, such as display name. We can call him Uncle or something. And then we have the line asset, which I also want to show you. And I think I mentioned with the line asset, you can attach a voice recording or a narration, for example, of Santa saying, ho, ho, ho. So what will go in here is just going to be the name of the file. But of course, to play that sound for real, that's not part of the job of this visual editor. It's basically concerned with taking all this information and putting it into a JSON file. But what you do with the information in that JSON file is then another thing that you would have to code in your game. And then let's collapse this and try option. And as you can see, I have not been doing a good job with spawning these nodes in the right places, but it will have to do for now. Let's say you can be have a naughty response or a good response, naughty response, I don't care. And the good, let's say you can say nice to meet you. You can also do conditionals here in options. Let's say you want to only allow this option to appear if you have a certain amount of brownie points. I have just some default people here, names of people here. Let's say you need to have 10 brownie points with Mabel to get this option to show up. And you also need 10 points from Letty to get this option to show up. But if you want to add another conditional, if your global variables have good kid, I don't know, and it's there in your save file, then this is going to play. And let's see, there is features. We will just name this feature. You can add a task, you can do a skill upgrade, you can change the money value, emit signals, or save variables. So the reason why I wanted to make features a separate node is because I want to be able to have multiple nodes linking to the feature like this. If feature was part of the option node, then it would get a little bit messy because you cannot keep track of what features there are, and every node is just going to have their own feature. And you can link them. Oh, I hate this sometimes. It's hard to link things in this graph. So, whatever, I give up. See, no, it's not working. Okay, yeah, it's still not. It's fine. It will work later. But then I also want to show you the dice roll. Well, this is not the best graph to work with. We will name this random and link this to the feature. You can choose the skill that is involved and what is the target number that you have to pass to pass and fail or fail. And of course, in classic dice roll fashion, you would have the different results. For fill, you could say you suck. You rock with the if you pass it. So yeah, and now I will attempt to link this again. Oh, it's just not working out in my favor. So then we also want to end the dialogue. So let's say this is end and we have the dialogue end feature as well to let to let the JSON file know that we're ending the dialogue. Oh, look, I hate this. It's just so annoying. The ports are sometimes not detecting and the file is saved in your directory. I use Godot graph nodes for this. You're going to have to code to tell Godot what to do with the connections, ports receive and put out. Then comes the dialog parser. If you watched my previous dialog system video, you know that the dialog parser is basically there to convert all the info you put into your visual editor into a humongous dictionary, and then you save that into a JSON file. And if you want to open a JSON file in your visual editor, the dialog parser will have to do the opposite. It will extract the JSON file, which is a dictionary, and put all the information back into their proper places in the visual editor. So remember to also save the position or offset of your graph nodes. So if you want to open an old dialog JSON file again in your visual editor, the nodes will be in the correct position. So then finally, you have your JSON file. This is the way I format it for your reference. Every node has a name, so you know which node connects to which node. If dice rolling is enabled, it will trigger a dice roller code and return a number. For example, if the number passes the skill check, then go to node 1, if not, go to node 2. Then just design and construct your custom dialog box in your game, which will probably be a separate Godot project entirely. For your game, you will need a dialog manager to take the shiny JSON file you have now and again extract information from the dictionary and put it in the correct places visually in your dialog box in game. So that's it, an updated dialog system. It might be a bit difficult for you to wrap your head around it if you're not familiar with making dialog systems, because even for me, sometimes in the middle of coding it, I still get really confused with what I'm doing and I have to write everything down on a paper to get a sense of where I'm at in the coding process. So be patient with yourself. Tips. Should you autosave? You know your tendencies. Do you want to autosave every 30 minutes, or would that be a bad idea? Some people lose progress because they forget to save, while some accidentally overwrite progress with autosave. That leads me to the other tip, save backups. Every time I save a dialog file, it will not overwrite the old file, but rather save as a separate file with the date and time it was saved. You'd have to do some cleanup with your folders often if you do this. It's better to be safe than sorry. A third tip is you can also implement shortcut keys with the input function. Only after making my first dialog system did I realize what my upgraded dialog system needs. The dialog system is tailored to the kind of games I myself want to make. Your approach may very well be different depending on the games you want to make and what kind of game dev you are. Are you more of a text or visual person? Are you working alone or in a group? Does your game have a lot of branching or not? Making games is fun, partly also because of the community. If you're making a dialog system for your game, we want to see in the Discord in the description below. Share your woes and thoughts on making a dialog system in the comment section below if you have any. And of course, like and subscribe. It replenishes my HP after every video. That's important because making a video takes a lot of HP. Yeah. Bye!